Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Curing the Incurable, Vitamin C, Infectious Diseases and Toxins, 3rd edition, by Thomas E. Levy, M.D., J.D., narrated by Stephen R. Thorne. Foreword by Dr. Gary Gordon. For years, I have highly prized Dr. Tom Levy's significant scientific contributions regarding the miraculous healing powers of vitamin C. I have heavily relied upon and referenced his book, Curing the Incurable, Vitamin C, Infectious Diseases and Toxins, in treating patients and teaching practitioners all over the world, and I am incredibly pleased to be asked to contribute to this 3rd edition release. Through the extensive published literature compiled by Dr. Levy, many now know which forms and in what dosages vitamin C is the most beneficial, proving that the accepted daily requirements of vitamin C are far too low for maintaining healthy cellular function and fighting off infections. Vitamin C, in what appears to be mega doses of 5,000 to 20,000 milligrams or more orally, and 20 to 200 grams intravenously, can and has saved lives even after all else has failed. As a young practicing physician, I did not learn the life-saving potential of vitamin C until I became involved in orthomolecular medicine for personal reasons. I was born with many difficult health problems, not the least of which was a stomach that was entirely intolerant to any more than 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C of the formulas available at that time. That was the beginning of an amazing journey embarked upon over 40 years ago. Since then, I have had the distinct privilege of working with giants like Dr. Linus Pauling, who originally coined the term orthomolecular, and other esteemed mentors in this exciting field, such as Dr. Abraham Hoffer, Dr. Robert Cathcart, and Dr. Harold Foster. These men have seen the power of aggressive nutritional supplementation in treating and even reversing chronic and acute illnesses, including heart disease and cancer. Those of us who have championed the cause of vitamin C and other nutrients given in megadose quantities have endured the scorn and even the wrath of our colleagues and peers, a paradigm that is swiftly and justly changing. Currently, we spend more on healthcare in this country than any other in the world, yet we are getting fatter and sicker while taking more and more pharmaceutical drugs. Deadly drugs are devised, mass-marketed, and sold by corporations making trillions of dollars off sickness and suffering. Unfortunately, the focus of mainstream medicine and the pharmaceutical industry is not about finding effective treatments. It's all about money. Most drugs only mask symptoms, ignoring the real underlying causes of disease, all the while generating new illnesses and conditions for which you will need another drug. The Wall Street Journal now reports that more than a quarter of U.S. kids and teens today are taking a prescription medication on a chronic basis, with nearly 7% of those on two or more drugs. Flu vaccines and antidepressants are prescribed to pregnant women, with known adverse effects upon the fetus, resulting in long-term chronic conditions for the child later in life. And according to the CDC, half of all Americans take prescription drugs on a consistent basis, with approximately one-third using two or more pharmaceutical drugs daily, and more than 10% of all Americans are frequently on five or more drugs at a time. In light of those statistics, it should come as no surprise that the Journal of the American Medical Association, JAMA, has reported that fatal adverse drug reactions, FADRs, are now the leading cause of death in the U.S. In Curing the Incurable, Dr. Tom Levy provides an extensive collection of scientific studies showing unequivocally that vitamin C, both oral and intravenously administered in high doses, taken orally in daily doses of 4 to 20 or more milligrams a day, and when needed, intravenously in doses of 30 to 200 or more grams a day, help mankind deal with many of our most challenging chronic and acute health problems. We must all learn what we can do to help ourselves deal with the myriad of healthcare problems we encounter, from minor accidents to the antibiotic-resistant infections that kill over 100,000 people each year. We must become fully informed of all options and fight the system for our inalienable right to choose natural remedies over conventional practices. Dr. Levy shows us how to save lives. We need more champions like him and champions like Ralph Fusitola, J.D., known as the Vitamin Lawyer, who has received numerous awards for his role in the 1995 DHEA cases on behalf of the Life Extension Foundation, and constitutional attorney Jonathan Emord, who has defeated the FDA in federal court a total of 8 times so far on behalf of First Amendment rights and the rights of citizens' access to alternative and experimental therapies. Many alternative modalities can be incorporated into mainstream medicine by consumer demand. That will follow when the public becomes more informed about the numerous other life-saving modalities available. If you were to ask me today, what is the one nutrient that is most beneficial to a person with impaired health, I would have to say that vitamin C is number one on my list. It has not let me down, and it won't let you down. Preface. In science, the credit goes to the man who convinces the world, not to the man to whom the idea comes first. Sir William Osler. To paraphrase Sir William Osler, discovery without dissemination and assimilation is meaningless. If the greatest discovery touches only very few minds, or if it touches many minds but is never truly comprehended, it is of no real consequence. As the listener proceeds through this book, it will rapidly become apparent that much of the original research reported was first conducted 50 or more years ago. Many different researchers and authors have been involved in writing about vitamin C, or the anti-scurvy factor, for well over a century now. Vitamin C has been proven to be such a fascinating substance that a large amount of research on its effects even preceded its precise chemical isolation. The benefits of fresh fruits and vegetables on the health of both man and laboratory animals did not require a precise knowledge of what it was in such food that so greatly improved general health. This book aims to do far more than just assemble much of the vast research on vitamin C, infectious diseases, and toxins in one place. The overall presentation of the information on vitamin C in this book is felt to be fairly unique. Many of the concepts and much of the information presented here have resulted from my continuing goal to better understand the numerous and undeniable clinical results that I have witnessed resulting from the proper use of vitamin C. This book also makes note of many more remarkable clinical results that I have not directly witnessed, but have discovered in the mountains of published research on vitamin C, or have had reported to me by some of my colleagues. Such results continue to be either unknown to, or ignored by, most conventional medical practitioners. The literature is virtually overflowing with irrefutable evidence that vitamin C is the single most essential nutrient for achieving and maintaining optimal health, and also the premier agent for curing or effectively treating a large number of the most common infectious diseases. Vitamin C is very arguably the most important therapy that most infected patients should receive, regardless of the diagnosis and whether other therapies and medications have already been started. Many clinicians and researchers demand a precise explanation for every result that they observe from a treatment or research protocol. Such total comprehension is a very desirable goal, but a lack of complete understanding should never stand in the way of using a therapy that results in the achievement of consistent and reproducible positive clinical results. Results are results, and knowing why a result occurs is generally only a luxury for the clinician and not a necessity for the patient's recovery. A lack of understanding can never negate a positive clinical result. Only the most intellectually insecure of clinicians would withhold a treatment that clearly works, especially when treatment is completely non-toxic, as established by extensive administration worldwide for over 60 years. While many other vitamin C authors have preceded me, the new millennium marks a period of time when more information is now available to researchers and clinicians than ever before in history. The Internet and the World Wide Web have provided an unprecedented availability of information on every conceivable topic. This veritable avalanche of information has resulted in every profession becoming much more liable for complete thoroughness and total integrity in the execution of its responsibilities to the public. Many medical authors appear to be wary of ever using the term cure. While caution to avoid misuse of a broad-spectrum term is praiseworthy, it is completely appropriate to use the term cure when the evidence demonstrates that a given medical condition has clearly and repeatedly been cured by a specific therapy. Chapter 2, the primary chapter addressing vitamin C therapy and specific infectious diseases, is designed to make it readily apparent when an infectious disease is curable, reversible, or preventable by the proper dosing of vitamin C. These determinations are based on a thorough and critical evaluation of world medical literature. An infectious disease will be considered reversible, as opposed to curable, when the optimal dosing of vitamin C clearly reverses some or all of the associated signs, symptoms, and abnormal chemistry tests. When such a reversal is complete and permanent, the medical condition will be considered curable. Avoiding the use of a term such as cure, when it is absolutely appropriate, does as much harm as using it inappropriately. Not realizing the incredible ability of vitamin C to cure a given infectious disease just perpetuates the usage of so many other needlessly applied toxic drugs and debilitating clinical protocols. If the shoe fits, wear it, and if the treatment works, proclaim it. Where appropriate, the potential benefits of properly dosed vitamin C on an infectious disease will also be proposed for the listener's consideration. Certainly, a reasonable inference can often be made on the clinical response of a given infectious disease to a more effective administration, usually intravenous, and a more generous dosing of vitamin C. This clinical judgment is based on much improved responses of similar infectious diseases when optimal vitamin C dosing is employed. Although not having the same value as a controlled clinical research study, a competent clinician should have the option to try vitamin C dosing regimens previously proven to be safe on another infectious disease. This should be allowed, even when the specific dosing regimen for the disease being treated has not been reported in the literature. In fact, a clinician is often expected to try a treatment regimen known generally to be very safe in one disease on a related disease that is largely unresponsive to other measures. This is the case even when clear evidence in the literature is insufficient to reach an unequivocal conclusion. Even though many clinicians might prefer the safe harbor of using only established therapies, the cautious use of therapies generally regarded as being safe for other diseases should be encouraged. This is especially true when the established therapies are arguably ineffective and sometimes even harmful. This book has been assembled with precisely those points foremost in mind. When a hypothesis based on limited clinical and research information is being proposed, this will be pointed out. However, when the totality of the evidence clearly indicates that vitamin C has cured a condition, this will also be asserted. Feedback from listeners is also welcome, especially when it represents an honest attempt to reconcile any of the incredible data cited that support the enormous role that vitamin C should be playing in the life and health of every human being. challenging me about something, and supporting that statement with honest scientific data is always welcome. Such feedback will only make me a better physician, and it will improve the quality of my future medical treatments and medical writings. Conversely, it is my most ardent hope that all other doctors who listen to this book can assume the same open position. Let the results alone speak for or against vitamin C. Obviously, propaganda and intellectual arrogance have no place in the esteemed practice of medicine. Researchers who are willing to speak against established medical concepts should be praised and encouraged by their peers, not isolated and ridiculed by them. If their new radical medical theories prove to be wrong, then those results will become evident. Medicine and science in general have rarely been significantly advanced by propositions offered by the majority versus the few. Independent minds like Galileo, Tesla, Newton, and Pauling have offered mankind opportunities to leap forward and not merely crawl along or even slip backwards. As Sir William Osler noted at the start of this preface, it is, unfortunately, far more important to convince the world that something is real rather than just to discover it and let the evidence speak for itself. Hopefully, this book will play a significant role in the discovery that vitamin C is an incredibly significant factor in maintaining and restoring the health of human beings. This book is dedicated to the many still unrecognized vitamin C researchers who have contributed a few deft strokes of the paintbrush, but have never had the opportunity to view the completed masterpiece, or perhaps to even know that the larger picture exists. Introduction. It takes much more than logic and clear-cut demonstrations to overcome the inertia and dogma of established thought. Irwin Stone. Amazingly, the medical literature already documents that vitamin C has readily and consistently cured both acute polio and acute hepatitis. Modern medicine still considers these two viral diseases to be incurable, regardless of the treatment used. It should be understood that both polio and hepatitis may sometimes spontaneously resolve, either relatively quickly or over a more prolonged period of time. However, modern medicine does not seem to be aware that properly dosed vitamin C will reliably and quickly cure nearly all cases of acute polio and acute hepatitis. Polio babies are completely well in less than a week, and hepatitis patients are sick for only a few days, not several months. Furthermore, chronic hepatitis does not develop in acute hepatitis patients treated with sufficient vitamin C. Vitamin C has also reversed and often cured many of the other common viral and bacterial diseases that continue to plague both children and adults. While a great deal of evidence exists to further demonstrate that properly dosed vitamin C can reverse and almost always prevent other significant medical conditions, such as cancer and heart disease, the best documented and most compelling evidence involves the cure of multiple infectious diseases that cause great suffering and often kill or incapacitate. As the listener hears a sampling of the enormous quantity of hard scientific evidence that has been virtually ignored on the effective treatment of infectious diseases with vitamin C, it will be much easier to comprehend that many more, although less well documented, applications of vitamin C remain equally unappreciated. Presently, modern medicine offers only a wide variety of vaccinations in the hope of affording protection against many of the infectious diseases. Little significant progress has been made in the actual treatment of nearly all the viral infectious diseases once they have been contracted. Antibiotics have made a big difference in the treatment of different non-viral infectious diseases, but the hallmark treatment for most viral infections remains supportive, directed at treating symptoms only, while hoping that the immune system can rally its forces. Either the body or the virus eventually wins, and the treating physician must wait, along with the patient, for the eventual result. With vitamin C, however, Such a scenario does not have to be continually repeated. For example, the scientific evidence presented in this book will conclusively show that the viral infection known as polio can be and has been completely cured by the proper administration of very high doses of vitamin C. The scientific evidence in this book will also conclusively show that vitamin C does much, much more than merely cure polio. Even though polio is largely an unknown disease to the younger generation and has become a forgotten disease to the older generation, any doctor, old or young, will tell you that polio was and remains a disease for which there is no effective treatment and definitely no cure. It is in the light of these amazing clinical results that the past, present, and future credibility of the mainstream, traditional medical establishment must be evaluated. Most doctors probably have the best of intentions, but they must nevertheless be held totally liable for their collective and persistent ignoring of the inescapable conclusions on the enormous clinical benefit of properly dosed vitamin C. At the height of the polio epidemic in 1949, when all young parents lived in the fear that their babies and young children would be the next victims, Frederick R. Klenner, M.D., published that he had successfully cured 60 out of 60 polio patients who had presented to his office or to the emergency room. Furthermore, he reported that none of the 60 patients treated had any residual damage from the polio virus that often left its survivors crippled for life. This evidence was subsequently presented by Klenner in 1949 to an annual session of the American Medical Association that dealt with the treatment of polio patients. You will find that Klenner's research and data are clear-cut and straightforward, and it will then be completely left up to the listener to determine how much information was ignored in the past and remains ignored today. Landwehr addressed in some detail Klenner's attempt to inform the American Medical Association about the incredible response of polio to properly dosed vitamin C. Klenner was also able to demonstrate repeatedly that vitamin C appears to be the ideal agent for killing any infecting virus. He repeatedly demonstrated that vitamin C is clearly the optimal choice to neutralize and often help eliminate nearly any toxic chemical or substance capable of poisoning the body, including the toxins associated with several of the infectious diseases. Additionally, you will see how Klenner and many other clinicians and researchers have conclusively shown that vitamin C appears to be the ideal agent for helping in the destruction of most bacteria, fungi, and other microbial agents that continue to afflict mankind. In addition to the utility of vitamin C as a single agent, you will see that the effectiveness of many traditional therapies for most infectious diseases is tremendously improved with the proper addition of vitamin C therapy. Although vitamin C is an incredibly effective single therapy for many infectious diseases, there are virtually no medical treatments for any infectious disease that are not substantially improved by the addition of vitamin C. The only absolute requirements are that vitamin C be given 1. In the right form, 2. With the proper technique, 3. In frequent enough doses, 4. In high enough doses, 5. Along with certain additional agents, and 6. For a long enough period of time. Anyone who has heard that information must surely be wondering how such a dramatic cure and treatment for polio, hepatitis, and other infectious diseases could possibly have been overlooked by so many caring, intelligent physicians and researchers. There is no simple explanation for such a situation. Most people, especially highly schooled ones such as physicians, doggedly persist in thinking as a group rather than as individuals contributing to a collective fund of knowledge. Once something gets etched into the pages of a medical textbook, and medical school professors throughout the country teach it to medical students and doctors in postgraduate training, any contradictions to this orthodox body of knowledge gets summarily ignored once these impressionable trainees become practicing physicians. This unquestioning faith in the established medical knowledge is so deeply ingrained that many doctors simply will not even consider something that comes from sources that they do not consider worthy of producing new medical concepts. And if they do accidentally encounter such information, they quickly dismiss it as just being ridiculous if it conflicts with too many of the concepts that most of their colleagues and textbooks embrace. As a practicing physician for more than 25 years, I can assure the listener that virtually all doctors fear being ridiculed by their colleagues more than anything else. This fear, more than any other factor that I can identify, appears to almost completely stifle independent medical thought. As Goethe once said, "We would rather admit our moral errors, mistakes, and crimes than our scientific errors." Certainly, a small handful of dishonorable physicians may realize that some unwelcome but legitimate medical breakthroughs could reduce their income, and they may oppose those breakthroughs for that reason. However, most physicians really care about and want to help their patients. The problem that remains is how to get physicians and the complete medical truth together. Thorne analyzed this resistance to innovation by some scientists, especially those who are physicians and clinicians. Although this book will address the incredible ability of vitamin C to effectively treat and cure many different viral diseases, and effectively treat a wide array of other infectious diseases, the following true story about another long-standing effective therapy will probably best illustrate why additional attempts to get the truth out about vitamin C must be made. On Sunday, July 2nd, 2000, a made-for-TV movie aired during the primetime evening hours. Entitled First, Do No Harm, it starred Meryl Streep, one of the most acclaimed actresses of our day. It was a fictionalized story based on real events in the life of a mother and her young child. The child developed epileptic seizures that proved to be progressively unresponsive to all of the prescription medicines that were used. Additionally, the child developed multiple side effects to the medications, with at least one being life-threatening. The child was finally offered brain surgery as a last resort, although not an option with much hope of long-term success. The child's mother, not one to just accept fate but determined to mold it herself, threw herself into research at the medical library. She discovered a treatment called the ketogenic diet, which the literature said completely eliminated seizures in a significant percentage of patients unsuccessfully treated with multiple seizure drugs. Her neurologist had not even mentioned diet as a possible therapy, even though this treatment had been in the medical literature for about 75 years. When the mother mentioned trying the diet, the neurologist only ridiculed her, labeled the reports of success with the diet as anecdotal, and even threatened to use legal action to keep her from transferring her child to Johns Hopkins in Baltimore to try the diet and avoid surgery. As might now be expected, the diet worked dramatically, and the child rapidly became seizure-free and remained off of all medications. The next day, in the doctor's lounge at one of the local hospitals in Colorado Springs, it was very apparent that the doctors as a group were indignant that their authority had been questioned by the movie, First, Do No Harm. When one of the younger doctors did assert that he should look into this ketogenic diet, the remainder of them rapidly built up a strong group negativity that welcomed only further negative comments about this treatment modality. Some of these real doctors' comments actually closely paralleled the negative comments of the TV movie neurologist. The doctors also assaulted the reports of positive responses to the ketogenic diet as anecdotal, even though it was very obvious that most, if not all of them, had never even heard of the ketogenic diet before seeing or hearing of the movie. This was in spite of the fact that many of these positive responses to the diet had actually been published. One doctor even referred to the internet as just another National Enquirer, implying that lay people are too hopelessly ignorant to ever discover vital information on their own, and that they are easily deluded by anything they might read. Another older physician asserted that he would need a full bibliography of medical references before he would even give the ketogenic diet passing consideration. As a group, it was generally expressed and accepted that it was impossible that any significant therapy for unresponsive seizure disorders could possibly have eluded them in the course of their medical training. Rather than join in the conversation, I just listened, and then I left without commenting. After I got home, it took all of about 3 minutes to get my computer online, access Medline, and find 180 medical journal references on the ketogenic diet. Medline is the database of the National Library of Medicine, containing over 11 million citations and author abstracts from more than 4,000 biomedical journals throughout the world, dating from 1966 to the present. In one of the more recent references in the April 2000 issue of Pediatrics, 11 studies on the ketogenic diet were reviewed. The authors concluded that the ketogenic diet completely stopped medically unresponsive seizures in a significant percentage of children. The diet also reduced seizure frequency by over 90% in an even greater percentage of children. Similar articles were found in the various neurology and epilepsy journals. Sadly, it would seem that many pediatricians and pediatric neurologists do not know what is in the most current issues of their primary and specialty journals. At the very least, it appears that what is studied is rarely independently evaluated and weighed in the mind of the doctor. Invariably, new and radical information simply must already be accepted by the majority of a doctor's medical peers to have any real chance of being utilized in patient care. Older, more radical information, ironically, seems to have even less chance of objective evaluation and practical application. It is of further significance to note that there has always been a consistent push to use prescription drugs whenever possible for just about any medical condition. Modern epileptic drugs were not available when the ketogenic diet was first discovered. However, the proper application of the diet is demanding and requires much more of an investment in time and effort than needs to be taken in the writing of a prescription. When the anti-seizure drugs first came along a few years later, the ketogenic diet quickly fell into disfavor. This is especially unfortunate, since epileptic drugs frequently have severe side effects compared to many other prescription drugs. Suffice it to say, however, that the ordinary physician rarely strays from what is contained in the primary textbooks, even if the current journals with which the physician should be familiar assert otherwise. A word about one of the most common physician criticisms of a concept that does not mesh with traditional medical information needs to be mentioned here. When something is labeled as an anecdote, the person reporting the information is usually being told that he or she is incapable of accurately reporting the response of a patient to a treatment. In reality, the dictionary defines an anecdote as being a short narrative that is unpublished. The most esteemed journals of our day often contain what are called case reports, which are nothing more than brief summarizations of the responses of one or a handful of patients to a certain treatment. A case report is absolutely nothing more than an anecdotal report that managed to get published. However, the published case report is typically written by a healthcare professional, and the information is often given the validity of a much more scientifically prepared study or article. In the final analysis, however, a case report is an anecdote, and an anecdote is a case report. The only differences are the reporter and the reporter's ability to be published. The layperson reporter or the non-mainstream medical doctor reporter will only endure ridicule and struggle to get published, while the mainstream doctor reporter will often get published and be awarded greater respect from the medical community for making a significant observation of a noteworthy clinical event. New, cutting-edge medical concepts from non-sanctioned sources frequently struggle just to see the light of day. The power of the textbook, also plays a significant role in the perpetuation of one treatment and the continuing opposition toward another. Even though the current medical literature clearly identifies diet as a very viable treatment for epilepsy, most doctors do not use treatments that are not yet in the textbooks, unless most of their peers are already doing so. In the 21st edition of the Cecil Textbook of Medicine, there is not even one mention of the ketogenic diet in the treatment of epilepsy. This medicine textbook has long been the gold standard for medical students and resident physicians nationwide. So how can it be that a legitimate epilepsy therapy of 75 years standing is not even mentioned anywhere on its pages, even when esteemed academic medical institutions such as Johns Hopkins and Stanford have championed the therapy and reported consistently positive results? A good question indeed. It doesn't even seem to be of concern to the average physician that the typical chapter in the medicine textbook is written by usually one and rarely two or more authors. This means that usually only one or two people are being relied upon to condense all the relevant information on a certain subject into the most pertinent and useful information. Furthermore, those authors are being trusted as having reviewed all of the important articles in the medical literature on a given subject. This book will readily demonstrate that a great deal of relevant information on the enormous value of vitamin C in the medical literature remains unacknowledged, or perhaps just ignored. Most reviews of vitamin C in the current medical literature mention or cite very little of the original research done on vitamin C. Sadly, this is a direct indicator that many other very relevant old concepts or other important pieces of information on any given medical topic never find their places in the pages of medical textbooks. Also, whenever a new edition of a medical textbook is published, you can rest assured that the treatment of a given topic will only vary in the slightest from the previous edition. Typically, the differences will be contained in the literature of only the last few years. In other words, if an important concept in the older medical literature doesn't make it immediately into the first edition of the textbook of its own time, it stands little chance of ever being properly appreciated, regardless of how important it may be. Truth be known, many physicians have outright disdain for any medical literature that is more than a few years old. It almost seems that even the best of scientific data is considered to have a shelf life, and if it is not immediately incorporated into a textbook, it will never be appreciated unless a modern researcher decides to repeat the study and rediscover the information. Under the entry ascorbic acid, the medical term for vitamin C, a Medline search promptly revealed a list of nearly 24,000 articles in its files. Furthermore, about one new article a day involving ascorbic acid continues to be published. Vitamin C has been and continues to be one of the most researched substances in the history of medical research. One indication of this popularity of vitamin C as a research focus came from King, who wrote an extensive review on vitamin C. At that time, he noted that his review was confined almost entirely to research papers which have appeared during the last 4 years. Nevertheless, he cited 169 papers. Ironically, vitamin C remains one of the most ignored substances in terms of practical application, in spite of the massive amount of research that has been done and continues to be done. The authors of many vitamin C research articles often end their discussions by encouraging further research and asserting that their articles are preliminary in nature only. This, in spite of the fact that tremendous positive responses to vitamin C for given clinical conditions may have been observed in the studies. An especially amazing example of this phenomenon is found in the study of Massel et al., which examined the clinical responses of 7 patients with rheumatic fever to vitamin C. All 7 patients had dramatic responses to vitamin C. Case 1's arthritis was gone within 24 hours of receiving vitamin C. Case 3 had been ill for 6 weeks, and by day 2 of vitamin C treatment, his temperature was normal and his arthritis was also completely resolved. Case 7, in the author's own words, was greatly improved after vitamin C therapy was started. Case 5 was noted to be obviously much improved. The other 3 cases had similar positive responses. Yet, at the end of this article, the authors note that no final assessments can yet be made regarding the possible therapeutic value of vitamin C in the treatment of rheumatic fever. And although the authors acknowledge that vitamin C is generally considered innocuous, they add that there is obviously a need for careful toxicity studies. It seems as though there could have been no clinical response dramatic enough and devoid enough of side effects that would have allowed these authors to dare suggest the routine use of vitamin C in the treatment of rheumatic fever. It would appear, for some reason, that the water is always a little too cold for swimming. In general, nobody dares to recommend a regular high dosing of vitamin C, even though a logical examination of most vitamin C research would suggest precisely that. There are very few human diseases or medical conditions that are not improved, at least to some degree, by the regular dosing of optimal amounts of vitamin C. There is only rarely a good reason for not immediately giving any patient large doses of vitamin C and then proceeding with the medical evaluation. In fact, Klenner reported that he would routinely treat with vitamin C first and then proceed with his patient evaluation. Furthermore, Klenner reported always having good results with this clinical approach. Basic research is certainly essential to achieve continued progress in medicine, but the landmark vitamin C studies that beg to be performed now should involve the use of only the highest of doses. Although Klenner achieved many amazing results with his vitamin C treatments, I could find no mainstream medical researcher who has performed any clinical studies on any infectious disease with vitamin C doses that even approached those used by Klenner. Using a small enough dose of any therapeutic agent will demonstrate little or no effect on an infection or disease process. However, this information cannot be used in concluding what the effects of much larger doses of that agent would be. Klenner would often use daily doses of vitamin C on a patient that would be as much as 10,000 times more than the daily doses used in some of the many clinical studies in the literature. And even though such tiny doses of vitamin C would often still show some incredible clinical or laboratory effects, a lack of response was frequently reported as well. A scientifically valid comparison between the effects of such vastly different doses simply cannot be made fairly. The medical literature, as revealed on Medline and in the literature that preceded the appearance of Medline, reveals many long-lost, ignored, or otherwise neglected scientific facts and assorted pieces of information. The examples of the ketogenic diet in the medical literature indexed on Medline appear to have remained unknown or unappreciated to actively practicing pediatricians, internists, neurologists, and neurological surgeons. It should come as no surprise, then, that numerous and dramatic pieces of medical and clinical information in vitamin C research can be found in 1990, as well as 1960, 1940, and even earlier. It should be easy to appreciate that when current research published in 1999 or 2000 is unknown to many physicians, even when it appears in their selected subspecialty journals, research data published in 1940 that never made it into the medical textbooks has no realistic chance of recognition by the vast majority of today's practicing doctors. Vitamin C research is also somewhat unique in that a very large amount of research was accumulated on it before it was ever chemically identified. Prior to this identification, it was just known as the anti-scurvy factor present in many fruits, vegetables, and other plants. Scurvy is the uniformly fatal disease that appears after the passage of enough months without any ingested vitamin C. Much of this older and less well-defined research still produced some amazing information, as will be shown. Every attempt will be made in this book to reference the old and new medical literature as much as possible. A motivated researcher can check out a great deal of the information offered. In general, it will be clear when I am offering my own explanations on the actions and effects of vitamin C, and when something is being directly cited from the medical literature. Often, a certain question is not clearly addressed in the literature, and I will attempt to use the existing information to reach a logical conclusion. This book is intended to challenge you, upset you, and hopefully even motivate you to action. This intention applies to both the layperson as well as to any healthcare practitioner. Yes, vitamin C has been shown to cure, reverse, and/or prevent many infectious diseases considered to be incurable and largely untreatable, except for some relief of associated symptoms. Yes, many viral infectious diseases have been cured and can continue to be cured by the proper administration of vitamin C. Yes, the vaccinations for these treatable infectious diseases are completely unnecessary when one has the access to proper treatment with vitamin C. And yes, all of the side effects of vaccinations, whether you consider them to be many or few, are also completely unnecessary, since the vaccinations do not have to be given in the first place with the availability of properly dosed vitamin C. It is long, long overdue that vitamin C is given its proper recognition and utilization in mainstream medicine. Furthermore, vitamin C needs to be recognized not in the micro doses that have been typically researched for some 65 years, but in the much larger, optimal doses used by Frederick R. Klenner, MD, and a few other noteworthy clinicians and researchers. Optimal vitamin C dosing should drastically reduce the use of many antibiotics and other medicines. After you listen to this book, see if you don't agree that properly dosed vitamin C would prevent a large amount of needless disease and suffering. Chapter 1. Some Basic Concepts and Historical Perspectives. Discovery consists in seeing what everybody else has seen and thinking what nobody has thought. Albert Sen-Ghurghi, M.D., Ph.D., awarded the 1937 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for the discovery of vitamin C in connection with biological combustion. A Theory of Life. Sen-Ghurghi proposed that the essence of the living state is that organic molecules, such as the proteins in the tissues of the body, must be maintained in a state of electron desaturation. All matter has varying proportions of electrons, protons, and neutrons, but Sen-Ghurghi held that dead tissue had a full complement of electrons, while live tissue maintained a deficit of electrons. Vitamin C, known chemically as ascorbic acid, interacts with a wide variety of basic chemical substances in the body. Vitamin C literally appears to be one of the primary substances assuring that a vigorous, continuing electron exchange takes place among the body's tissues and molecules. Sen-Ghurghi asserted that energy exchange, arguably life's most important form of cellular communication, can only occur when there is an imbalance of electrons between and among molecules. This imbalance of electrons causes the natural flow of electrons, a biological form of electricity, throughout the body. All of the body's functions are directed, controlled, and regulated by this physiological flow of electricity. Furthermore, this flow of electricity through the body also establishes and maintains the subtle magnetic fields in the body that appear to be involved with good health. Vitamin C, although possessing other important qualities, appears to be a most important stimulus to this flow of electricity. A greater amount of vitamin C in the body enhances the flow of electricity in the body, thereby optimizing the ability of the cells in the body to maintain their health-sustaining communications. One definition of life, then, is that it is a state in which an optimal degree of electron interchange among cells can take place. Health exists when electrons flow fully and freely. Illness exists when this flow is significantly impaired, and death occurs when this flow stops. Furthermore, when this electron flow is impaired, there is a need for more vitamin C to help remedy this impairment. Since poor electron flow throughout the body's tissues appears to cause or be associated with disease, this also means that there is typically a vitamin C deficiency whenever the body is diseased. Because of this interrelationship, vitamin C should always be a part of the treatment of virtually any disease state. Just as dehydration requires water, poor electron flow, a primary characteristic of the diseased state, requires vitamin C. This will virtually always apply, even when a deficiency of vitamin C was not necessarily involved in the development of a certain diseased state. There are only a few situations in which some restraint should be exerted in the administration of vitamin C, and these will be discussed in Chapter 4. Entrenched misconceptions. The enormous clinical usefulness of vitamin C remains little appreciated. This lack of appreciation is partially due to its classification as a vitamin, which is a very limiting definition. In the 28th edition of Dorland's Illustrated Medical Dictionary, a vitamin is defined as a general term for a number of unrelated organic substances that occur in many foods in small amounts and that are necessary in trace amounts for the normal metabolic functioning of the body. While vitamin C is certainly necessary in at least trace amounts for the body to survive and to avoid the deficiency disease known as scurvy, much larger amounts are necessary for the body to achieve and maintain optimal health. That definition pertains much more to the other identified vitamins rather than vitamin C, and only trace amounts of vitamin C will not support the normal metabolic functioning of the body mentioned in that definition. Rather, the chronic underdosing of vitamin C from minimal or no supplementation and from eating depleted food will facilitate the development of nearly all the chronic degenerative diseases that affect man. Furthermore, the evidence that will be presented throughout this book will clearly and repeatedly demonstrate that chronic vitamin C depletion is often one of the primary reasons that many common infectious diseases are contracted in the first place. It will become apparent that many people throughout the world, including many in the seemingly well-fed United States, are suffering from the effects of a chronically deficient intake of vitamin C. It is very possible that much of the success claimed by mainstream medicine in both improving lifespan and decreasing the incidence of infectious diseases has come from the addition of small amounts of vitamin C, along with other antioxidant nutrients, to many of our otherwise depleted packaged foods. The degree of this success should improve further as time goes by, as it is becoming increasingly accepted to supplement a greater variety of foods with even larger amounts of vitamin C. As addressed in some length in the introduction, an established scientific concept, however wrong, is very difficult to correct once accepted and given the credibility of publication in medical textbooks. The information in this book will repeatedly demonstrate that a vitamin-like function is only one of multiple significant properties of vitamin C. Arguably, since it will be shown that much larger than trace amounts of vitamin C are needed to be taken on a regular basis to maintain optimal health and normal metabolic functioning, a strict interpretation of the definition of vitamin C can even support the argument that vitamin C is not a vitamin at all. Ultimately, it should become apparent to the listener that vitamin C is the single most important nutrient substance for the body, regardless of whether it is viewed as a vitamin. However, For purposes of discussing the massive amounts of literature that have been generated on this fascinating substance, I will continue to refer to it as vitamin C throughout this book. The scientific and medical literature contains a few other names for vitamin C based on the nature of its chemical composition, but they will not generally be used to avoid any possible confusion or appearance of inconsistency to the listener. Another critical misconception regarding vitamin C involves how much of it should be used to achieve the intended therapeutic effect. Real estate agents frequently say that the three most important attributes of a home are location, location, and location. Similarly, the three most important considerations in effective vitamin C therapy are dose, dose, and dose. If you don't take enough, you won't get the desired effects, period. On the other hand, you will rarely ever fail to observe a dramatic response to a wide variety of medical conditions if you take a large enough dose for a long enough time. On the other hand, even the use of relatively tiny doses of vitamin C will frequently result in some clearly definable benefit in many infectious diseases. Nearly all of the past and present papers in the literature that declare the ineffectiveness of vitamin C for given conditions use incredibly small doses of vitamin C in their experiments and trials, while looking for dramatic and clear-cut benefits. The recommended daily allowance, RDA, of vitamin C ranges between 30 and 95 milligrams daily, with 60 milligrams being recommended for adult men and women. Often, the proper dose of vitamin C in the treatment of an infectious disease may be anywhere from several hundredfold to several thousandfold times the amount in this minuscule RDA dose. The RDA serves to prevent only the development of the full-blown clinical picture of scurvy in otherwise clinically healthy people, or to restore vitamin C blood levels in otherwise normal people to the levels deemed to be normal or acceptable. Indeed, in many people who have infectious diseases that metabolize unusually large amounts of vitamin C, keeping body stores of vitamin C depleted, the RDA for vitamin C will not even prevent many of the symptoms of scurvy from developing or restore the blood levels of vitamin C to the normal range. Evidence contained in this book will actually demonstrate that many people with such vitamin C depleting infectious diseases actually die from complications completely consistent with the symptoms of acute scurvy. For example, many people who eventually die from an infectious disease actually die from a bleeding complication. An acute and severe vitamin C deficiency is often the immediate underlying reason for either subtle bleeding or massive hemorrhage. Many of the numerous vitamin C research papers are also especially misleading in their conclusions, since they persist in labeling the small amounts of vitamin C used in their studies as megadose. Even the amounts of vitamin C that are termed megadose in the literature often need to be increased a thousandfold or more to reach the necessary dosage actually needed to achieve the desired therapeutic effect. Because of this continued mislabeling in the literature, I will refer to the amounts of vitamin C that really should be used as optidoses, optimal doses. Although many of the optidoses recommended in this book will be substantially larger than most of the megadoses mentioned in the literature, the use of the term optidose may gradually allow doctors and patients alike to realize that the recommended dose is really the optimal dose that the body needs at that time. It is also important to realize that the optidose of vitamin C, even for a single patient, can vary widely, depending upon how sick the patient already is when therapy is initiated. Furthermore, one optidose is not necessarily appropriate for two patients with seemingly similar clinical situations, since one patient may have underlying factors consuming vitamin C much more rapidly than the other patient. On the other hand, a megadose only implies that the treating physician feels that a large dose is being recommended, and the dose given may still not necessarily be the physiologically appropriate dose that will support or restore optimal health. Taking regular optidoses of vitamin C tends to make the patient much more aware of the subtleties of good health. When something occurs that will compromise that good health, such as a new toxic or infectious challenge, it is not uncommon for the experienced vitamin C taker to reflexly increase the daily vitamin C optidose to the needed amount. The chronically healthy person almost always knows when even small reversals in good health are taking place, and taking enough additional vitamin C at such a time will almost always promptly restore good health, as well as make the contraction of any infectious disease extremely unlikely. Genetically lacking. Vitamin C must be directly ingested, usually in the form of supplementation, as well as in the diet, to maintain adequate levels inside the cells in the tissues versus the more commonly measured levels in the blood throughout the body. Tissue cells contain greater concentrations of vitamin C than are found in the blood. As a result, ingesting only enough vitamin C to maintain a given blood level is no guarantee that many of the vitamin C-rich tissue cells will have enough vitamin C available to them from the blood to reach and maintain their proper concentrations. It should also be realized that the human body does not have the ability to synthesize any vitamin C whatsoever. However, this is not the case with most other animals. Generally, nearly all mammals, reptiles, and amphibians have the ability to synthesize at least some of their daily requirement for vitamin C. Most mammals synthesize vitamin C in their livers, first measured experimentally by Grolman and Leninger, and other animals, primarily reptiles and amphibians, can achieve this synthesis in their kidneys. This ability is felt to be completely lacking in humans, as well as in primates, fruit bats, and guinea pigs. Interestingly, the very fact that the guinea pig cannot make any vitamin C for itself is one of the primary reasons that it has served scientific researchers so well. The guinea pig can be made ill or toxic much more easily than a vitamin C-producing research animal, and there is less variability in the guinea pig's response to a given stress compared to other animals that can respond with internally produced vitamin C. Researchers quickly realized that guinea pigs and primates, including man, seemed uniquely susceptible to a wide variety of clinical syndromes, including life-threatening shock and infectious diseases such as tuberculosis, diphtheria, and polio. Of course, it eventually became apparent that experimentally induced scurvy required an animal such as the guinea pig that could not produce its own vitamin C, or another animal that could produce only small amounts. Chatterjee et al. Examined the abilities of different species of animals to produce their own vitamin C. Among the mammals tested, they found that goats were especially capable of producing significant amounts of vitamin C. In fact, goats had a rate of production of vitamin C that was roughly 13 times greater than that of cats or dogs. All wild animals tested had at least a fourfold greater rate of vitamin C production compared to cats or dogs. This is likely one of the primary reasons that these two most common domestic pets will keep the veterinarian busy with so many of the same diseases that afflict their human owners. Although they do produce some vitamin C, dogs and cats produce it less readily than many other animals, and compared with wild animals, they are much more easily stressed into a state of vitamin C deficiency. For example, the efficient vitamin C-producing adult goat can internally manufacture more than 13,000 milligrams of vitamin C daily to maintain its optimal health when it is not facing any significant challenges to its health. Even more amazingly, goats are also believed by some to produce as much as 100,000 milligrams of vitamin C daily when faced with life-threatening degrees of infectious or toxic stress. Researchers, such as Levine, have argued that it is quite difficult to recommend an optimal daily dose of vitamin C for the human being. However, few investigators familiar with the bulk of research on vitamin C would maintain that the human RDA dosage is nearly enough to meet all of the body's needs. Connie et al. demonstrated that animals having the ability to synthesize their own vitamin C could produce about 10 times more than their baseline levels when subjected to enough biochemical stress, such as from drugs. This automatic ability to adequately step up vitamin C production in the face of stress explains why so many wild animals tend to live healthy for their entire lifespans until it is time to die. Conversely, generally vitamin C depleted human beings will typically spend at least half of their lifetimes coping with one or more chronic diseases. Dogs and cats are generally somewhat healthier than people, but their limited vitamin C synthesizing ability is eventually overwhelmed as they grow older and face greater cumulative toxic stresses, resulting in more disease than seen in wild animals. Even the rabbit, which can produce roughly 5 times as much vitamin C internally as the dog or cat, can be malnourished to the point of eventually dying from what appears to be a metabolic condition closely akin to scurvy. It should not be hard to understand, then, that an added vitamin C-utilizing condition, such as a significant infection, can push even vitamin C-producing animals to the point of clinical scurvy. The specific genetic defect that prevents humans from internally synthesizing vitamin C is the lack of a liver enzyme known as L-glutinolactone oxidase, GLO. GLO is the last of a sequence of liver enzymes that ultimately transforms glucose, blood sugar, into vitamin C. Interestingly, the actual GLO genome, or sequence of coding DNA, has been identified to be present in humans. For unclear reasons, this segment of human DNA remains untranslated, meaning the recipe for GLO is present in the human but remains unprepared. This raises the possibility of potentially exciting new avenues of research for today's genetic researchers. If a way can eventually be found to get the already present genetic code for GLO to turn on and continually produce GLO, the health of the human population will leapfrog to levels that may seem literally unbelievable today. Human beings would then be able to continually synthesize vitamin C from glucose, and there would be far fewer toxic or infectious challenges that could cause illness. As is already seen with the many vitamin C-producing wild animals, such a human could then be expected to remain much healthier until the expected lifespan had run its course. A thorough examination of the literature reveals another potentially exciting way to address the human being's inability to synthesize vitamin C that does not appear to have been seriously addressed. While not always practical or clinically effective, genetically based enzyme defects can sometimes be addressed by the direct administration of the missing enzyme. Sato et al. Administered GLO harvested from either chickens or rats to guinea pigs. Giving this enzyme to guinea pigs enabled them to survive vitamin C deficient diets. At the very least, this should stimulate further research into the feasibility of giving such direct enzyme replacement therapy to humans. Hadley and Sato established a protocol involving long-term GLO administration to guinea pigs that was successful in maintaining a high proportion of those animals. These results would certainly seem to warrant further serious research on similar treatment programs for humans. Assisting the liver in performing what should be a natural function is a very desirable clinical goal. Perhaps regular therapy with GLO enzyme replacement, supported by more vitamin C when toxic and other environmental stresses present themselves, might be a very good health-supporting regimen. Certainly, stimulating the liver to release vitamin C directly into the bloodstream would undoubtedly help support the oral and other non-intravenous forms of supplemental vitamin C. The scientific literature specifically addressed in Chapter 2 clearly shows the vast clinical superiority of intravenous vitamin C over any other form of vitamin C administration. Often, a significantly smaller dose of intravenous vitamin C compared to an oral administration will promptly result in the clinical resolution of an infectious disease. A human's inability to produce GLO must be considered something of an inborn error of metabolism. This metabolic error was also induced in the vitamin C-producing rat by Mizushima et al. They were able to establish a mutant rat colony that produced no GLO, the same defect normally found in guinea pigs and humans. As with other such inborn errors of metabolism, every attempt should routinely be made by a treating physician to consider this lack of enzyme activity in every medical condition. This translates into a very simple approach. Always give vitamin C on a daily basis, and always give enough. To date, there are no infectious diseases that have ever been found in which vitamin C administration can be considered dangerous or inappropriate. This is the case, even though there has already been roughly a century of research on vitamin C, involving the publishing of some 50,000 to 100,000 scientific articles. A handful of case reports, which will be addressed in more detail in Chapter 4, gives good reason to exert a minimal amount of caution when administering vitamin C under a very limited number of clinical circumstances. However, no evidence has ever been produced to demonstrate that a regular opti-dose of vitamin C should be avoided by anybody. Everybody requires an opti-dosing of vitamin C on a daily basis to reach and maintain optimal health. No human body can operate effectively and stay healthy without such an opti-dose. The only real question that remains is what one's individual daily opti-dose should be. This, too, will be addressed later in more detail. It is an incredibly rare situation for an inborn error of metabolism like the one resulting in GLO deficiency to be shared by all humans. There are many other inborn errors of metabolism, but these affect only certain unfortunate individuals. However, there appears to be a primary assumption in the medical community that a 100% GLO deficiency is a genetic trait shared by all human beings. From my review of the scientific literature, however, it does not appear that a serious study was ever undertaken to see if all humans were equally lacking in this critical liver enzyme. Consider the anecdotal reports that one occasionally hears about a certain individual living to 100 while smoking and drinking every day of his adult life. Although one can be blessed with a much better immune system than others, the ability to synthesize GLO, at least to a limited degree, could also be the reason for an otherwise incredibly long and healthy life. Any inborn error of metabolism is also not completely expressed all of the time. Certain enzyme levels may be depressed by 10%, 50%, or 90%, but not necessarily 100%. This must also be considered a possibility for the levels of GLO in different people possessed of greater longevity, at least until careful studies can determine otherwise. Cummings pointed out that some individuals enrolled in vitamin C depletion studies were discontinued from those studies when no symptoms of scurvy developed, or when vitamin C levels did not drop significantly over an extended period of time. It seems that there was never any serious curiosity over whether these individuals could continue to have vitamin C in their bodies over even longer periods of time. If any individuals could be identified with even partial GLO production and internal vitamin C production during periods when dietary vitamin C restriction resulted in scurvy for the remainder of the individuals studied, even more exciting avenues of research could be pursued. It is always easier to research a condition that is not possessed by all. Further support for the concept that all human beings might not be completely lacking in GLO and the internal production of vitamin C comes from studies with guinea pigs. Williams and Deason reported that one guinea pig continued to survive after 8 weeks on a vitamin C-free diet, which should have produced scurvy. Before long, several other investigators concluded that some guinea pigs could synthesize vitamin C, thereby accounting for the occasional wide variability in the laboratory requirements needed to induce scurvy in these animals. In spite of this research, there still does not appear to be any enthusiasm or significant interest in looking systematically for those occasional humans who can also synthesize some vitamin C. Cummings further points out that if the lack of GLO in humans comes from the same recessive genetic trait as is found in other genetic enzyme deficiency states, then occasional mutations should be expected to occur that would again allow GLO to be expressed and vitamin C to be synthesized. However, if any of that is true, a deliberate search should be made to find such vitamin C synthesizing individuals. Some findings may fall into a researcher's lap, but many must be specifically sought out, or they will not be found. Historical background. In its classical and full-blown form, scurvy is a painful, unrelenting, and uniformly fatal disease. Few physicians today ever get the opportunity to even see a case of classical scurvy of the kind that decimated navies, armies, and explorers of centuries ago. A treatise on the scurvy describes the first symptoms observed that heralded the appearance of scurvy. The first indication of the approach of this disease is generally a change of color in the face, from the natural and usual look to a pale and bloated complexion, with a listlessness to action or an aversion to any sort of exercise. When we examine narrowly the lips or the corners of the eye, where the blood vessels lie most exposed, they appear of a greenish tinge. Meanwhile, the person eats and drinks heartily and seems in perfect health, except that his countenance and lazy, inactive disposition may portend an approaching scurvy. Classical scurvy in humans can only occur when vitamin C levels in the plasma, the fluid part of the blood free of cells, approach zero and remain so for a number of months. Lund and Crandon et al. Reported on the deliberate induction of scurvy with a vitamin C deficient diet. Crandon was able to eventually demonstrate in himself a complete absence of circulating plasma vitamin C. He developed small skin hemorrhages after about 5 months and demonstrated poor wound healing after 6 months. Other investigators were able to induce the signs and symptoms of scurvy in a group of 5 prison volunteers before plasma vitamin C levels completely reached zero. The ability of any given individual to develop scurvy will depend upon how absolutely the diet is deficient in vitamin C and how healthy and well-fed that individual was before the vitamin C intake was stopped. The body's stores of vitamin C vary significantly, and the presence of underlying diseases and chronic toxin exposures will also substantially increase the rate of utilization of whatever vitamin C stores are present. As vitamin C levels in the plasma approach zero, the levels of vitamin C eventually become severely depleted throughout the tissues of the body. When the depletion of vitamin C is severe enough, the scorbutic, scurvy-stricken, individual is incredibly weak and prone to very easy bleeding. Virtually all motion produces excruciating pain, and the gums are typically infected. Teeth are no longer soundly anchored in the gums, and the breath develops a putrid smell from the infection. The skin is mottled with spots, many of which relate to bleeding within the skin. The legs and knees also tend to be swollen in the late stages. The immune system is always severely compromised, and a secondary infectious disease, such as tuberculosis or pneumonia, will often take hold and end up being the immediate cause of death. Interestingly, many scurvy victims did not appear wasted and malnourished. Rather, full-blown scurvy would also occur in individuals who were overweight and considered well-fed in terms of the food amount eaten. This observation seems to underscore the important concept that a good quality and proper variety of foods are vastly more important for overall nutrition than the amount of food eaten. Lind, who came to be known in Great Britain as the father of nautical medicine, conducted what many considered to be one of the first experimental clinical trials that utilized a truly scientific methodology. While on board ship, he selected 12 sailors who already had scurvy, and then formulated 6 different regimens of dietary supplementation to be given to 6 groups of 2. All of the sailors were given the same basic diet throughout the day. 2 sailors also received 2 oranges and 1 lemon daily for 6 days, while the remaining 10 men received other dietary supplementation that did not contain any significant amounts of vitamin C. Lin's other supplementations were termed elixir vitriol, vinegar, seawater, cider, and a concoction containing nutmeg, garlic, mustard seed, horseradish, barley, myrrh, and cream of tartar. At the time, all of these concoctions were considered as candidates for having some anti-scurvy effects. After only 6 days, the 2 fortunate recipients of the citrus fruits had already recovered to the extent that they could resume their normal onboard duties. The trial could not continue any longer because Lind only had enough oranges and lemons to last 6 days. None of the other men showed any significant improvement, although the 2 men given what was only termed cider, along with the regular diet, did show some lessening of their weakness. Lin's trial also served to dramatically demonstrate that very little vitamin C given for a very short period of time can still be very effective in acutely relieving the symptoms of clinically full-blown scurvy. Because a vitamin is generally considered to be needed in only very small amounts to prevent a known deficiency disease, this dramatic clinical response of scurvy to very minimal vitamin C dosing is the primary reason that vitamin C first came to be considered a vitamin. As mentioned earlier in this chapter, however, such minimal doses of vitamin C are only enough to prevent the advanced symptoms and fatal complications of scurvy. Such small doses will not prevent the development and perpetuation of the many diseases associated with chronic vitamin C deficiency. Summary. Vitamin C has long been mislabeled as a vitamin, at least in the strictest sense of the definition. This mislabeling has been one of the primary reasons that the proper dosing, optidosing, of vitamin C remains largely unappreciated. Improper dosing of vitamin C continues to be the main reason for any scientific paper to claim that vitamin C was without effect in treating a given infectious disease or medical condition.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.